Can we separate the art from the artist? Even if we can, should we? What moral responsibilities do we take on when we engage with creative works made by people who have caused harm? These questions are common in both academic and popular discourse of culture and media, further galvanized in recent years by the outing of many a beloved public figure as a dangerous predator. But as important as these discussions are, the questions highlighted are also a dodge. It's misleading to frame these issues around we. Can we separate the art from the artist? In Clara Dieter's words, we is an escape hatch, a way of simultaneously sloughing off personal responsibility and taking on the mantle of easy authority. We, in other words, is a way to avoid I. Can I separate the art from the artist? And if I can, should I? That's what I want to talk about today, and specifically how my perspective on the art versus artist debate was fundamentally shaped as a child by professional wrestling. The story begins when I was 10 years old with a little game called Mortal Kombat Deadly Alliance. It was the fall of 2004, and I had just moved to a new town and spent my time after school with a bunch of other kids at a local sitter, mostly playing PlayStation 2. And the game we gravitated to most was Mortal Kombat. Colorful, intense, and bursting with personality, it was unlike anything I'd ever played. I excitedly borrowed it one night to see if my parents would buy me my own copy. They took one look at the gameplay and... No, no, no. They would not be allowing that in their house. I was upset, but my parents said I could get a different fighting game that was less M-rated. So when I stumbled across the rated T for teen SmackDown Shut Your Mouth in a used games bin, I asked if I could get that instead. I'd never watched wrestling before, but I figured muscly dudes hitting each other couldn't be that different from Mortal Kombat. It took me a while to wrap my head around grappling and suplexes rather than just punching, but once I did, SmackDown quickly became my favorite video game. More than that though, I fell hard for professional wrestling. I started watching Raw and SmackDown each week. I spent hours on WWE.com, reading about the history of various championships, and watching very low quality videos. I bought tons of old wrestling VHS tapes. I would read wrestler biographies, and look for any excuse to talk about wrestling for school assignments. Eventually, my parents got me a subscription to WWE On Demand, which hosted old wrestling shows and features.
Hey wrestling fans, I'm Jerry the King Lawler. Welcome to the World Wrestling Entertainment DVD board game!
I was completely obsessed. Wrestling was all I wanted to talk about. And while I had a lot of favorite wrestlers, no one ever came close to Chris Benoit. My initial reasons for gravitating towards Benoit were not especially sophisticated. He was Canadian, he had the same first name as my dad, and he had a son named Daniel. But the more wrestling I watched, the more I was drawn to Benoit's work in the ring. Chris Benoit never had the most colorful personality or the greatest mic skills, but his matches were just the best. That might not make sense to people who don't watch wrestling since it's all fake anyway. And sure, wrestling matches are predetermined, but wrestlers still need to give a physical performance that conveys a story in the ring. And no one was a better in-ring storyteller than Chris Benoit. He had a varied and high-impact moveset, could sell his opponent's offense for maximum drama, and brought a physical intensity to bouts which was palpable. So convincing was Benoit that despite knowing wrestling was fake, when you watched him, he made it seem real. Benoit's use of submission holds like the crossface and the sharpshooter also made the endings to his matches nail-bitingly suspenseful. And that suspense was genuine, since unlike a John Cena or a Hulk Hogan, it was not a foregone conclusion that Benoit would win. He wasn't a company-appointed face of the WWE, but a scrappy underdog who succeeded based on his hard work and tenacity. While he'd found great success wrestling in Japan, in America, Benoit spent a lot of his career overshadowed by giants, or their more eccentric personalities. As a kid, my favorite characters were never the squeaky clean heroes who always won. They were the side characters with the chip on their shoulder, who had something to prove. Chris Benoit may not have been an anti-hero like Vegeta or Seto Kaiba, but he similarly didn't always win. and that made cheering for him like dedicating yourself to a cause. This sense of being the underdog overcoming the impossible was never more apparent than in Chris Benoit's road to the World Heavyweight Championship. In January of 2004, the reigning champion Triple H was feuding with Shawn Michaels. The two had a long history. When Michaels was champion back in the 90s, a still up-and-coming Triple H was his best friend. But when Michaels left the WWE with a career-threatening injury, Triple H began to rise up the card, his growing ruthlessness turning him into a headlining draw and world champion. But now, Michaels had returned, and all roads seemed to lead to a showdown at WrestleMania for the World Heavyweight title. Just one problem. Chris Benoit had won the Royal Rumble. The Royal Rumble is a yearly 30-man battle royale. Every 2 minutes, a new competitor enters, with the last man standing winning a world title shot at WrestleMania. In 2004, Benoit entered at number 1, lasting for more than an hour and defeating 29 wrestlers to win a shot at the gold. Benoit did not belong in the title picture. This was a long-standing feud between Triple H and Shawn Michaels, certified main eventers who were supposed to headline Mania. But in winning the Rumble, Benoit's work rate could no longer be denied. And so, a triple threat match for WrestleMania was made, all three men fighting to be the champion. Benoit entered Madison Square Garden the fan favorite, more than keeping up with his peers. But even so, it was clear he didn't really belong. At one point in the match, Michaels and Triple H would even team up to take Benoit out of the equation permanently. A bloody and beaten Shawn Michaels would then take to the ring and beckon Triple H, as if to say, now the real stars can finish this. But the ever tenacious Benoit fought his way back in, eventually dispatching Michaels. And just when it seemed like Triple H would be able to sneak away as champion, Benoit would lock in the crossface, his patented finisher that had garnered countless submission victories. Desperate and with no way out, Triple H too would submit. The underdog had done it. After 18 years of wrestling around the world, both Chris Benoit the character and Chris Benoit the man had proven their worth as the absolute best. It is no doubt the defining moment of his career, one that I watched over and over again. But if you've never watched wrestling, you probably still know who Chris Benoit is. By June 25th, 2007, my passion for wrestling had waned a bit. I still followed the WWE, but wrestling was no longer an all-encompassing obsession, as I gravitated to comic books and movies. Nonetheless, I was excited. Benoit was booked in a match for the vacant ECW World Championship at the Vengeance pay-per-view the night before, and I was confident he'd won his third world title. I got home late and turned on Monday Night Raw a few minutes into the show, still not knowing the results. But upon flipping the channel, I was surprised to see Benoit's 2004 Royal Rumble victory. I thought, maybe they're playing career highlights because Benoit won last night, before a chilling realization. They don't play your greatest hits when you win a championship. They play your greatest hits when you die. Seconds later, the words, "In memory of Chris Benoit," graced the screen. Tonight's Raw was to be a tribute to Chris, a collection of his greatest matches and moments, along with emotional interviews with those who knew him. I was devastated, so much so that I didn't find it peculiar that Benoit's wife and son had also passed away. I spent much of the show in tears. But as bad as I felt then, I'd feel a lot worse the next day, when the full story came out. Between June 22nd and June 23rd, Chris Benoit had murdered his wife, murdered his son, and finally killed himself. Theories as to why were and are abundant. Steroid abuse was suspected early, but more contemporary research suggests a combination of severe brain damage following numerous concussions, a deep depression brought on by the death of Benoit's close friend Eddie Guerrero, and alcohol abuse as likely factors. The WWE were quick to erase Benoit from their history, never mentioning him on TV and scrubbing him from their website and products. It's only in recent years that he's once again appeared in WWE content, and even then, in an extremely limited capacity. While news media exhausted the story in the weeks and months to follow, I just became numb to the whole thing. That Benoit had died was upsetting, but that he also destroyed his family was something I couldn't even begin to make sense of. I tried to keep watching wrestling, but the experience was just too upsetting. By the end of the summer, I had canceled my WWE On Demand subscription, had no idea what major storylines were unfolding, or who was holding the championships. I just didn't care. My hero was gone, and in more ways than one. Right now you're probably thinking, man, if Dan's parents had just bought him Mortal Kombat, they'd have saved him a lot of heartbreak. And yeah, you're definitely right. But as much as I would never really love wrestling the way I used to, I didn't exactly stop liking Chris Benoit. I still found his matches incredibly exciting. I still looked back on his hard-won victories with joy. I still thought he was the best wrestler of all time. I now had to reconcile all these warm memories of someone with the harsh reality of who they really were. At 12 years old, it was the first time I had to face the question of separating the art from the artist, and I consciously made the choice that Chris Benoit could still be my favorite wrestler while simultaneously condemning what he'd done. How else could I continue to like the work of a murderer? Separating the art from the artist seemed a good answer. This would turn out to be useful practice. It was about a year later I started to really fall in love with movies, a passion that's still shaping the direction of my life. The history of film being, of course, littered with all manner of great art made by various problematic people. For years, I've been content to just separate the art from artist and engage with the work regardless. I didn't worry about whether or not Stanley Kubrick's treatment of Shelley Duvall on the set of The Shining was appropriate, or weigh the ethics of watching movies directed by convicted child rapist Roman Polanski. But as I get older, I found it more and more pertinent to re-examine my instinct to separate art from artist, and to take a closer look at what I'm actually doing. The very concept of separating the art from the artist has a long history, dating back to the New Criticism of the early 20th century. This was a form of critique which advocated for judging work without the context of the author, believing great art could stand on its own. By this logic, the question is, do Chris Benoit's matches still hold up on their own merit? And the answer is unequivocally yes. Benoit's in-ring physicality and technical skill is still exceptional, and probably worth studying for students of the craft. New criticism would be iterated on by Roland Barthes in The Death of the Author, where Barthes argued meaning lie not with the creator of a text, but with the reader, who made meaning through their interpretation. Such a position is highly applicable to pro wrestling, where the live reaction of the audience plays a profound role in shaping the meaning of the work, sometimes in open defiance of the artists. Take, for example, Roman Reigns' victory in the 2015 Royal Rumble, and the unceremonious elimination of beloved workhorse Daniel Bryan rejected this entirely. And so, upon winning the Rumble, supposedly good guy Reigns was met with a chorus of boos. A moment best summed up in this image of a perplexed The Rock, totally bewildered as to why the fans were so venomously booing his cousin. Another victory. Despite what Bot may think, most contemporary critics agree that, in Constance Grady of Vox's words, it is not particularly useful to strictly ignore an artist's biography when assessing their work. Nor is it even practical to do so. Benoit's matches may indeed hold up perfectly well on their own terms, but they don't exist in a vacuum free from the context of his double murder-suicide. And the meaning of a text may well exist within the mind of the reader, but anything the reader knows about the artist can and often does influence the meaning derived. Furthermore, while the phrase "separate the art from the artist" is informed by decades of scholarly debate, when most people use it, it's not to evoke Bot or art theory. It's specifically referring to engaging with art made by monstrous people. And despite claiming to separate the art from the artist, that's never really what I've done. When I watch Rosemary's Baby, I'm not pretending it's authorless. I'm actively considering how its themes of justified paranoia and psychological trauma reflect the rest of Polanski's filmography. Separation in this context specifically refers to separating the morally repugnant behavior of the artist from one's enjoyment of a text, not the artist's full biography. Hell, what first drew me to Chris Benoit were aspects of his biography that I related to, and even when my fandom was more rooted in his work as a wrestler, there was still a feeling that I somehow knew him. I understood that as a wrestler, Chris Benoit embodied a fictional persona, but the lines between character and person are thinner in wrestling than they are in, say, film acting. In his essay on Bill Cosby, philosopher Philip Dean posits that there is an intimacy to the stand-up comic's relationship to the audience, claiming, quote, "A stand-up does not aspire to accuracy, it does aspire to the truth." I'd argue the same is true of professional wrestlers. Now that may seem absurd given how theatrical pro wrestling can get. Mark Calloway is not really an undead wizard, Glenn Jacobs is not really his demonic younger brother, who is not really the son of demented funeral director Paul Bearer. But as Super Eyepatch Wolf has pointed out in his own videos, pro wrestling frequently blurs the line between fiction and reality. As an example, consider the already discussed feud between Triple H and Shawn Michaels, former best friends made bitter enemies. The two's supposed hatred for each other is a pure fabrication, with both men remaining close friends in real life throughout their careers. But it was true that Triple H played second fiddle to Michaels in the 90s, and that when Michaels left long-term due to injury, Triple H had become a main eventer in Michaels' absence, only for Michaels to return in 2002 and threaten Triple H's spot in the main event. So the tension that H might be in Shawn Michaels' shadow was well-founded, a real-life feature which factored into their fictional feud. Chris Benoit, similarly, may have played a fictional character, but one which mirrored many aspects of himself. The fiercely intense drive, dedication to the business, technical mastery, respectful discipline, by all accounts, these were equally true of Chris Benoit the man as they were Chris Benoit the character. He may not have actually defeated 29 opponents in the 2004 Royal Rumble, but his victory reflected a career where he had every obstacle against him becoming a main event draw, all of which he overcame through sheer work rate. His tears upon winning the world title at WrestleMania were not a performance, but a genuine outpouring of emotion for having achieved his childhood dreams. Separating the artist from a moment like this in the strictest literal sense is functionally impossible. The real Benoit is there. The question is, how do Benoit's real-life crimes bear on his work in the ring? Film and ethics philosopher Baris Gott argues that the crucial factor when it comes to art made by monstrous people is whether or not one can detect traces of these monstrous attitudes in the art itself. Roman Polanski is an apt example of this. Looked at in isolation, it's easy to interpret Rosemary's Baby, Repulsion, or Chinatown as feminist texts, which reflect how the violent and sexual abuses of women are normalized and go unpunished within patriarchal societies. But this reading is a lot more fraught, given Polanski is himself an abuser whose crimes have largely been minimized and unpunished. This knowledge recontextualizes the films, suggesting the violence suffered by Rosemary, Carol, and Evelyn may in fact be a perverse fetishism. Now it's important to stress that these readings are subjective interpretations, not objective summaries. I'm not trying to say these movies used to be one thing and are now something else. What I'm trying to illustrate is how the traces of Polanski's violence can come to bear on his films and change their meanings. Even as someone who considers themselves a fan of the aforementioned movies, the prevalence of sexual violence and abuse of women in Polanski's body of work does disturb me in light of his own abuse. Conversely, philosopher Theodore Gracek argues that a disparity between an artist's public and private persona can also make, quote, an ethical and aesthetic difference. Here, moral discomfort does not come from detecting traces of immorality within the text, but because the text embodies ethical virtues that are known to be an inaccurate facade. The definitive example of this is most certainly Bill Cosby. In both his stand-up and his roles on television, Cosby presented himself as an arbiter of morality, his humor rooted in being a relatable and upstanding family man. The Cosby Show's Dr. Cliff Huxtable was at one point held as America's dad, a role Cosby clearly took to heart, given his efforts to police black Americans and the proper ways to behave. Such moral posturing, we now know, was that of a serial rapist who used his position of power to inflict abuse for decades. With some exceptions, it's difficult to find traces of these crimes within Cosby's art, but the disparity between Bill Cosby the serial rapist and the wholesome family values of the Huxtables, or the goofy charm of a father feeding his children chocolate cake for breakfast, changes the context of the latter. Regardless of the explicit values of the text, the real Cosby haunts the facade of his art, creating an unseemly quality. With Chris Benoit, there are both traces and disparity within the art. On the one hand, professional wrestling is a form of performance rooted in violence, in using one's own body to inflict pain on others. And even among wrestlers, Benoit's character was defined by a unique ruthlessness, willing to destroy his opponents and his own body in pursuit of his goals, a disturbing echo of the brutal crimes the man would commit. Even on the mic, Benoit's promos would often dwell on the sacrifices that he, his wife, and his children have made. And while these aspects of the art mirror Benoit's horrific double murder suicide, there's another trace between art and life that I can't shake. Following his death, scans of Chris Benoit's brain by neurosurgeons from West Virginia University found evidence of chronic traumatic encephalopathy, or CTE, a disease brought on by sustained head trauma known to cause depression, dementia, and erratic behavior, also known to affect boxers and NFL players. While it would be inaccurate to lay culpability for Benoit's actions at the hands of the WWE, his CTE was no doubt the result of a lifetime of head injuries sustained as a professional wrestler. To engage with his art, then, also means engaging with the work that destroyed his brain. But amid these many traces between the art and the artist, there is also disparity. Though Benoit did play the heel from time to time, his defining character was that of an underdog hero, someone I rooted for because he seemed earnest, hardworking, and like he genuinely deserved to be champion. And it's much harder to hold that view of a man who killed his wife and child. Benoit's matches may technically be unchanged, but the shift in my knowledge has nonetheless produced an aesthetic difference, because the premise of matches, that Chris Benoit was the good guy the audience would want to see win, stands in stark contrast with how the man is remembered. In both traces and disparity, Benoit's double murder suicide weighs down on his work as a wrestler. How then can said work be enjoyed ethically? Taking a position of an ethics rooted in outcome, the question is more specifically, does enjoyment of Chris Benoit's wrestling career create some form of harm? A common talking point in regard to these kinds of discussions is monetary support. There's no harm in, say, simply enjoying Bohemian Rhapsody, but paying to see the film in a movie theater or buying a Blu-ray is also implicitly a way to financially support Bryan Singer. But because Benoit is dead, it is literally impossible to materially benefit the man in any way. The WWE has been extremely reticent to profit off of Benoit, excluding his matches from DVD releases and largely omitting him from company history. The only way to actually buy Chris Benoit merchandise is used through third-party sellers, but there isn't an industry actively profiting off of his name. But while I can enjoy Benoit's matches knowing I'm not giving a dollar to a murderer, I also think this is a rather flimsy defense of media engagement. Because even before considering the ethics of monstrous artists, the fact is, most forms of consumption involve some level of immorality, and the WWE is no stranger to immorality. Vince McMahon may not be making money off of Benoit's name, but the company still underpays and overworks its talent, does not provide health insurance for workers expected to jump through flaming tables, profits off a very cozy relationship with the Trump administration, and produces propaganda twice a year for the murderous royal family of Saudi Arabia. Point being, consumption under capitalism is so inextricably wound up with exploitation and the immoral that I don't think we can rely on monetary support as the ethical barometer when it comes to art from the monstrous. Another consideration is the harm an individual's enjoyment might produce. Does my enjoying Chris Benoit matches cause harm to others? And it certainly could if, for example, I were to profess my love to others who are themselves victims of abuse or who simply find dwelling on Benoit's crimes traumatic and uncomfortable. But this is easy enough to avoid. I just have to keep my enjoyment of old Benoit matches to myself. It's not like there's much opportunity to enjoy the man's work beyond privately watching old DVDs or YouTube videos, and given I know all of two people who I can talk about wrestling with, it's pretty unlikely Benoit's WWE career is gonna somehow come up in most of my conversations. Taking myself out of the equation, any sort of public celebration of Chris Benoit the wrestler is also highly unlikely. A frequent conversation on wrestling podcasts and interviews when Chris Benoit comes up is should he be inducted into the WWE Hall of Fame? And the answer amongst industry professionals is universally no. Whether it be an ethical judgment or a pragmatic one, the consensus within the pro wrestling community is Benoit should not and will never be inducted. Using these ethical frameworks then, it seems personal enjoyment of Chris Benoit's wrestling career is totally viable. But while that answers how I can still enjoy Benoit's work, it doesn't answer why. If the traces and disparity of the artist's horrific crimes are on some level inseparable from the art, then why does that art still mean so much to me? I don't really know. I've tried to use various theoretical and ethical frameworks to address the art versus artist debate, and I'm right back to where I started, having to reconcile my love for an art with the sad reality of the artist. And that idea is manifest in many of the readings I looked at for this video. While the art versus artist is a philosophical debate, it's also a deeply personal question. Most of the writers I've cited are open about loving an artist who did monstrous things, and the pain of processing that feeling. Many describe not just an ethical objection, but a perceived personal betrayal, a sense that they were deceived and hurt by someone they felt a kinship with. This is not a rational judgment, it's an emotional one. And while that might sound wrong, the fact is, personal emotions are central to consuming art by monstrous people. Theory and ethics can be used to inform our understanding of the concept, but whether or not we can separate the art from the artist comes down to what we feel. We have to choose for ourselves. I have to choose for myself. But one thing I have learned is that I was wrong all those years ago. Separating art from artist is not an answer. It's a process. In mentally separating Chris Benoit's horrific actions from Benoit's artistry as a professional wrestler, I'm not looking for an excuse for my feelings. I'm trying to make sense of those feelings.